like to give a big thanks to Humming Bee for letting us have this event. We've been hosting this event here for the last 1 year, and it has been great. People, we are trying to raise awareness about conscious consumption and production. We have Tanya Devaya, who is a senior campaigner at Jatka.org. Next, we have Srinivas Haveli, co-founder and volunteer coordinator at Citizens for Bengaluru. Next, we have Ruhi Kumar, who is a communications and media manager at Greenpeace India. So, here's how we're going to do it. I have a couple of questions that I would like to ask them. Just to set the tone of the event, and after that we will keep it open to the audience.
Who is an activist, right? Or you different? Everyone who's here is an activist. Who's taken time out on a Tuesday evening to be here and listen to some of us here. That means you're an activist. Unfortunately, these words, like Tanya was saying, the labels have all these problems right now. If you say the UPCM is not good, immediately you became Rahul's best friend. It's not like that, right? You don't do that. So let's not worry about these labels. You know, activism is something that you do when you made enough money or you got a roof on your head and you can go home and sleep somewhere and you are close to it, and you start thinking about the larger public. And if you do anything in that realm of things, then I would call you an activist. And the less exciting and scary the word activism begins, the more activism will happen. So we want everybody to think of themselves as activists, and being activists should become cool and nice.
Anyone can be an activist if they have an interest in doing something positive. I stay away from labels, so I don't ever call myself an activist. I always get called an activist. It seems like it's a profession, but it's not. Activism, it's not a profession at all. It's something that all of us have it inside us. Whether you call it an activist or, you know, like Tanya said very well, an enabler, it's about the will and the want to do something when you see something. And it could be in your household, it could be on the street, it could be at a government level, it could be at a municipality, local level, but the moment you give a label, you are segregating it from something else. I would also steer away from the word change a lot. It's more about the shift that you want to create in the society, because people don't change suddenly or over time. They shift from one place to the other. And in order to do that, you have to sort of, you know, enable that from inside. So that would be something that I would relate as activism.
Another thing I was wondering, what goes on behind your campaigns? So from Satyagraha to sign up, the pace of campaigns have changed. How does that work for all the people in the
with the current work that I'm doing with Jatka, so behind the scenes, people always think that it's a petition that's doing the work, but the petition is just a tool. It's a place for you to, it's your public face, for somewhere for you to collect and show a collective action. But there's a lot that goes on behind the scenes. There's a lot of strategic thinking that goes on. There's a lot of research that goes on into why we should take an action that, and why we want people to act on a certain issue and how we want them to act on that certain issue. There's a lot of talking to who we call the targets of a certain campaign, who we want to move to make a certain decision. So it takes a lot of effort to do this sort of thing. It may not seem like it, but it does. And we are also constantly innovating, because we want to find new ways of doing things that we've been trying to do for decades in India. Not even decades, like centuries in India, right? We have no dearth of social movements in our country. Activism is in our blood. We just need to, you know, realize that. And for me, the kind of work that we do is an experiment to see that we have new tools at our disposal. So why let only people who want to make profit out of it use those tools? Those tools are for all of us to use. So yeah, Let's figure out a way to do that. So that's what happens at our place, yeah. Yeah.
Jatka has some really, really cool integration of technology and people, so we are partners with them on some of the things that we do, and it's amazing that how this is enabled. What goes on behind the scenes is a big, big dark secret, as we can't tell you all those things. You see, if I tell you that, then we'll stop all the flyovers, all the things, and, you know, suddenly we'll have more trees and no public transport, right? So, so much development will happen.
No more development.
I'm being sarcastic. Actually, a lot of exciting fun stuff happens. We have so much fun that volunteers look forward to coming to volunteer meeting. So that's how much fun that we have. For one of the campaigns that we did recently called Chukbuku Beku that she was talking about, you know, the name itself came about through some fun conversation about how do we get people in Bangalore realize that, look, there is 140 kilometers of railway line and 40 railway stations, except that unlike Mumbai or Chennai or any other city, we don't have local trains. And that railway line is gathering dust and like four trains are going on it every day without using it for local trains. So how do we communicate this? So we came up with this. Somebody said Chukubutu Beku. There's a song, there's a music, and a very famous hit song. Many of you are much younger than me, so you may remember that, but it's an Emma song. So that's how that whole thing came about. So with that, we started doing the train thing and the volunteer meeting, running around the whole thing, and created a video out of it, and that got more people. So where I'm going with this is we try to make it an extremely, I was just talking to somebody from the organizing team earlier, a non-threatening environment where there is no big, you know, mega thing happening behind the scenes. Whatever is happening, everybody knows what's happening, and you all can participate in it to the extent of the time and, you know, interest that you have. The secret to a successful volunteer moment is that you create an environment where the work is broken down in such small pieces that everyone in the team feels like, oh, this much I can do that. And somebody else will, I can do that. So if you put it all together, you are doing some big, big, big thing that actually can reverse the nation like steel flyover. So what happens behind the scenes is just the usual talking. How do we influence people? How do we communicate?
Basically, there's a lot of thought process that goes on about identifying the right the target. Because, understanding that what is it that we can do to act as a catalyst to hand over the power to the people, because we have the tools, and the tools can be used by people, and then what is that shift that can be created. So there's a lot of brainstorming that goes on. And some of the best ideas have come out of, brainstorming with in the teams and even, for volunteers. And it's really fascinating because there's so much of creativity and an outburst of energy in the strategy point, because everyone's like, what, we should say this and do this. And I was like, yeah, we totally should plan that. So there's a lot of interesting things that go on, and this creativity that happens, and it's probably one of the coolest times to be in a campaign, in a strategy and planning phase, and that's about it.
Thank you. So my next question is, what are the ethical issues that you, ethical dilemmas that you face in your campaigns? So for instance, there is a lot of, when you talk about social media campaigns, there is a lot of guideline that goes to it in terms of, mob mentality, like what happened in India with the Safety Basics campaign, where Facebook just put it out, and then I think according to the Wall Street Journal, they had like 11 million people signing up, and then the PR guy came out and said, your people don't know what they're signing up for, and, so how do you deal with that?
So it's interesting you bring that up, because we were also part of the the net neutrality related campaign. So first of all, I don't understand this term of social media campaign, because no campaign is only run on social media. That is never true. There's something at the back or the front of that, So I don't understand that concept. But you're right in that there is a trend now to have like these really aggressive and or really negative and positive conversations that are only on social media and are kind of removed from reality. So the key thing to remember is that if you're going to take action on some issue and you find it on social media, try to investigate into what that issue is and how that particular action you're taking, there's a thought behind why that action was designed. And usually, at least the way we think about it at Jhatta is, it's a way to, there is some pressure point of a person you're targeting or the issue you're working on, and which is why that tactic is designed. it's not designed merely for the purpose of having visibility, right? So only with some awareness sort of campaign, then you might do something that's purely visibility driven. But otherwise, there is usually a logic to why we do things, right? So I would say kind of be critical about what you read, investigate it a little, and also try to understand the issue before you, you know, sort of either comment on it or take action on it. So there's, I mean, for us as well, because we use a lot of digital media, you receive a lot of feedback and sometimes not so happy feedback, and you know, which sometimes I feel people really need to delve a little deeper into more than thinking that this is a meme and that's it and there's no reason. Because why would we do it if it had no reason? Like, I don't want to waste my time either, right? So I think we need to be a little bit more critical about why certain things are designed that way. Feel free to reach out to the people who have posted those things and ask a question. Nobody is going to hesitate to answer that question. So instead of judging those things, try to have an open mind, engage in a conversation, figure it out, and then if you support it, take that action, is what I would say.
In the software world, there's a very famous thing that we say, that we say, talk is cheap, show me the code, code meaning programming code. So everybody can talk, I can do this, I can do that, I can build an app. So this kind of thing is also like that. You know, everybody has an opinion, and many opinions that, you know, in this world of trying to, every single person feels some kind of moral responsibility to comment on the day-to-day happenings of everything in this world, right? And there's a tremendous peer pressure too. It's for the kind of audience that we have, the people that we are, I'm talking about the political and you know, social issues more than the selfie crowd that's probably much bigger crowd than this view. So the ethical issue is really something that bothers me, in the sense that if you look at the problems faced by Bangaloreans or Indians in general, right, there is things like steel flyovers and public transport, these are issues. But then there is also terrible malnutrition. There is infanticide. There is, you know, girl child that is dead before even born. I think there's no end to the number of issues that we have. So when the consciousness as a group collectively raises to a certain level, then people start acting on it. And when we act on it, it should be framed in a format where people feel like that goal we can reach. Can we end malnutrition? Maybe not. Can we do something to improve the midday meal scheme? Maybe we can. Oh, can we do it for 5 schools? Yes, that sounds easy. Can we do it once a week? Oh, that's super easy to do. I can do that. So, you know, you need to be able to understand the large picture and bring it down to what can actually be done. And then there is always this hierarchy of morality, right? You know, you are trying to come here and you are, you know, the red light, the green is turning red and the organizers are calling you, you need to make it on time. It's just going to turn red. Are you going to jump the signal or not? Well, you're not going to kill somebody, a lot of people follow somebody else. Oh, he did it, so I'm behind him. There's a very famous book called The Games Indians Play. I suggest all of you read that. It explains Indian behavior using game theory and why we do what we do. Right? So ethical things, moral things, these are all, you know, I would like to not be judgmental about that, but keep things simple. I'm speaking on behalf of CFP or as a sense of Bangalore kind of a moment here. The only reason why it works is you are doggedly focused on one thing, okay, public transport, right? Every day there are 10, 15 things that come to us saying, can you work on this? Can you do that? Can we now do that? Can you? We try to say, yes, we can, but let's do this first. And if you try to do 10 things, nothing will ever get done. So try to keep the focus on whatever you're trying to work on, and don't try to take every single thing, that question that comes up, and try to analyze it deeply and write a PhD paper on it. Try to put it aside and focus on what it is that you're trying to do. Because the only thing that breeds success is success. So you need to actually make some change happen. Some real things should happen on the ground that are visible, perceptible, like the statement that says, steel flyover is now cancelled. You know, you need to see a news headline like that. Only then you will be able to get momentum to do other positive things. Less than 10% of the rainwater that is falling on the Bangalore city is harvested, you know, more than 50% of the water needs are met right there. Most people are not even aware of that, right? Nature is giving us rain, catch the rain. So this needs to become a citizen moment. Last year I did something like that. In my area, I used to work on a lake called Puttenhalli Lake. Some of you might have heard about it. It's a revived lake, thanks to a lot of activists, lake activists and friends that worked on it. But what I noticed is I live in the street right next to the lake, and the stormwater drain that literally passes in front of my house and goes into the lake is completely blocked. So I tried to get my neighbors and the street people together to clear the fundamental reality that we all have to accept is that, you know, none of these are really technically our job responsibility. Alright, we got stuff to do. I have 2 kids at my home right now, and they're going to call me and ask me where I am very soon. And this tomorrow morning, I need to get back and report into my work. Though many of our volunteers are still surprised that I actually have a job. I flew into somebody by showing my card just now. What I'm saying is, the people that are supposed to do this are also us, right? We live in a representative democracy. Somebody is representing you. If the Bangalore water crisis is looming, instead of the lady on the left can bring up the question in a panel like this, I want this question to be brought up in the state assembly every day. I want a very, very informed debate and discussion happening where they bring in the experts, bring in the farmers, bring in the, you know, water tanker mafia just to get their side of the story. Have a discussion, have a debate, make laws, create a framework, policy framework, do all of that stuff. All of this is not happening, right? Why is it not happening? I think the problem is that those of us that work on these kind of things for a long time, and I myself am one of them for many years, you know, we've been in this mode of, how do I put it? You know, Satyajit Ray mode, I would say, right? You know, so immediately you can think of Fab India, Kurtas and stuff like that. These activists and all that stuff that she was talking about earlier. We need to move into a different mode, right? What is the different mode? And this is really one of the things I wanted to, you know, make an appeal to the folks that are here also. So I'll take a couple of minutes to talk about this. We all know that education is broken, right? You know, from LKG to nursery to engineering, it's broken. 70% of the graduates cannot perform the job, right? Everyone read this report. You all believe in that, right? I myself have got a gold medal in engineering. Couldn't do nothing, right? I mucked up for the exams. I got great marks and got all that stuff. So education system need to be reformed. We need to stop doing rote learning and start doing more rational, hands-on, 2 things that actually give you innovative capabilities and all that. Now this is the message I want to convey, right? So I can do a message, I can do this in the form of a paper or a long post on Facebook that nobody's going to read beyond 2 lines, or I can make a movie called 3 Idiots, right? I want that all of us, the so-called activists on the mode, to move out of the Satyajit Ray mode into Rajkumar Hirani mode. When we start communicating the issues that affect all of us in a way that people actually connect to, like they can connect to that Rancho Das or whoever that name is in that movie, you know, and subtly sending the message about the education system is broken, we need to do it this way, the parents get the message, how much stress you're putting in it. So many things have been conveyed in a very entertaining manner that people can connect to. Instead of a long policy discussion that EPW that only 400 people read or whatever, right? These things are not going to go anywhere. No disrespect to any of them, right? We need all of that stuff. But if you want to get the larger public out there, like you want to get 8,000 people out there, you can't lecture them to come to a human chain. You can't lecture them the benefits of this and that and whatever. You got to tell them beta. That's it. You say beta. You don't want it. Why? Different people have different reasons for saying beta. But you got to convey beta. Stop. Don't want. Chukubuk beku. Don't give me all the logic and railways department, state government, who needs to spend money, all of that. Give a clear, concise message that people connect to. So I am calling out to all of you. Many of you seem to be really cool people with a lot of
interest in communication, and I see a lot of people with cameras and all that stuff. So think of how we communicate the issues of the day in a way that most people connect to. And that's the kind of work that we are involved in. And it will really help all of us, whether it's Greenpeace or JETCA and all of us. We always struggle what to put in that 140 character SMS. What do we say when we respond to that? Because, you know, there is a message we're conveying. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Kia, and I'm a documentary filmmaker, and I've been traveling in India for past 4 years, and what I have been noticing is that, you know, people ask, we are living in cities and we sit here and talk about sustainability, which is just the 30% of us, right? But there is that 70% which is actually, they are living sustainably. For example, if you take Rajasthan, they are completely aware of, you know, what to wear, what food to eat, which will support, you know, their digestive system. So I just want to know that, are we trying to bridge that gap we have, like people who are living in cities and people who are living in villages, because they've been looked down upon. So, or are we trying to learn from them?
Thanks, Kia, for the question. That's a really interesting one, because what we do here versus what's happening there, right? I think more and more what we're doing is also getting aware of how we're doing it. The urban centers have become places of massive waste consumption, leading to extreme pollution and poverty. They're all interlinked. So there is some sort of, you know, things coming together in an urban sprawl. And you're talking about people living on the fringes of the city, what we, or some people term as urban poor, right? So I think what is happening in some of the urban centers is trying to understand that how we can contain it within this circle, right? Because as you look at it, like in the next 30, 40 years, we're gonna have an intense growth in a number of cities in across Asia and Africa. We're gonna have the biggest mega cities coming up in two of these continents. So there lies the opportunity to see how we can build more sustainable cities, right? And what you made the point you made about, like, people living in Rajasthan already adapted to that sort of lifestyle, is that because I think that sort of overconsumption pattern doesn't really exist in many of the villages. And people are being pushed in those communities to migrate to urban centers and then living on the fringes and then getting into this vicious cycle of how we're living. So I think the people who are trying to work towards sustainability in cities is not just from the perspective of that, yes, this is the ethical way to live, but also from the futuristic point of view, that if we really want to survive in cities and this is how cities are going to look like, then we better make our cities sustainable. Otherwise, we are up for a big battle within the cities.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Ashish. Loving the discussion so far. So I'm very interested in transport. I'm a huge believer in public transport. Just like to ask, how many of us who came today took public transport to come to Hamintree today? So I'm just curious, like, kind of directed at Srinivas, but also other panelists could answer. Like, there are some other Indian cities which have done a great job, and Bangalore has not done such a great job so far. Also, if you want to incentivize people to take public transport, you have to make it convenient and easily accessible. Simple things like, can the disabled board a bus, right? It's still not a reality in most Indian cities. So I'm just curious to hear thoughts on public transport and how do you incentivize more people to take it?
Yeah, the story of Indian cities, and is somewhat connected to the earlier last question also, that answered beautifully. You know, somehow in this mad rush of development and cities growth and all of that, we have kind of lost our way, right? In Bangalore, in 2005, the percentage of all transport in the city that is done using public transport is about 55%, right? And that was done primarily through the BTS, or the Bangalore bus service. Unfortunately, the demand for the suburban train is 30 years old, it's still not realized. Now, in 2015, it has dropped to 45%. But that number might look like 8% is a small number, But in the meanwhile, what happened? 60 lakh vehicles have been added to the street. Entire city of Chennai got added to the entire city of Bangalore. So the Bangalore of 2015 is equal to 2005 Bangalore plus 2007 Chennai equal to 2015 Bangalore. That's our growth, that curve that we have. So public transport has utterly, completely been neglected and gone. Now, is it only the government's problem? I think this is where your question really is. No, it isn't. People always do what makes sense for them. You know, people always do what makes sense. I plan to take a bus and then take a metro. Someone told me that this place is very close to metro, I can get on a metro. I tried to do that, I couldn't. So finally ended up with an Ola share somewhere and 10 minutes late to this and all of that. It is not convenient, it doesn't work that the way you expect. So we all have to do something about that. Now, in terms of people and incentivizing, I think the biggest incentive is people always do things if it is cheaper and faster and better, right? You give them cheaper, faster, better, they'll do it. That's it. Our primal instinct takes over. Whether it is a website to book a hotel or to travel or anything, we find a way to do that. So we need to do that. Huh? Delhi Metro has done amazing. Now, I think in Bangalore, Metro will take a long, long time to come whenever it comes and all of that. So in the meanwhile, we have the bus is what we have. That's why we are now doing this campaign called Bus Bhagya Beku. And the idea of the Bus Bhagya Beku is to dramatically increase the presence of bus in our city. All the IT and BPO companies today, a lot of them deploy Indicas and cab services. Why can't they incentivize the employees to take a bus? Imagine you go into a work and if you show your bus ticket or whatever, you travel by bus today, you get free lunch.
Sometimes I have this urge to turn it around and ask, what are you willing to do for it? So we are people like us are also willing to do quite a bit, but I think there's a serious need for us to kind of step back and analyze why the larger picture of how this issue arises. So one of the campaigns that I and the team at Jhatkar we have been kind of focused on for a while now is related to protecting the Western Ghats, as much of the Western Ghats as you possibly can, because that pretty much is the lifeline for many states along this coast. So I think there's a serious need for people in cities like Bangalore to use your voice to support those struggles happening in places like Coorg, which is the birthplace of the River Kaveri that feeds this city. Kind of start thinking about it, start reading about it, and find ways to take action. We'll also be doing the same and trying to get those opportunities out to you. But there is a very serious need for us to remove the blinkers and stop thinking about it only when a moment occurs, right? Every summer we start thinking about where my water is going to come from. Why do we not think about it in the other months of the year? So there are a lot of things that we need to consistently be thinking about. And it's nice that these questions are coming up, because now we can start having these conversations, and that possibly will help all of us to think, you know, from a wider perspective of why these things are happening. So while I completely agree that each of us can do small things in our everyday life, like start setting up rainwater harvesting systems in your house, try to use as less chemical-based detergents, etc., in your daily life so that it doesn't flow in through the sewage systems into our lakes and rivers, and hold your local, protect your areas around you. Like if you see somebody, you live near a lake or bed area, you see somebody starting construction, do something with your resident, like your welfare association in that area, stand up, right? At that moment, voices and physical presence really counts. But on other moments when that, you know, that instance is not happening, like a concerted effort to understand the larger things that are going on and support struggles happening a little further away from you is very required. And if we do that, I think in a long-term basis, perhaps we can make things better.